buried alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. Yeah, I see it now. I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the prize for mine.
I greet you in the name of Jesus, and I thank you for being here. We're here today, I really believe, by a divine appointment. We never plan these. And I thank you for your willingness to walk this part of the journey that Tina Marie Gingrich, we desire to speak life in this situation. Even in brokenness, there's beauty and redemption. And so I would like us to just worship God together in this service. And we're going to trust God to lead us by the Holy Spirit. So I'd like us to pray and dedicate this to the Lord. And there's some songs that the children and that were kind of favorites of some of these of Tina Marie. And we're going to have a song, and then Pastor Dan will share a devotional meditation or the obituary as well. So let's pray. Father God, we bow to worship you. We welcome your presence, and we thank you for your presence. And God, today we ask for a fresh baptism, an anointing, a filling of the Holy Spirit on each one. Lord Jesus, in your word, you said when we seek, we find, and if we knock, you'll open. And God, we come asking and seeking and knocking for your presence, for your comfort, for your anointing, for your peace. And God, we dedicate this service to you. We thank you that even in tears and in brokenness, there's life and there's beauty in Jesus Christ. We dedicate this service to you. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Fading here today and gone tomorrow.
Greetings to each one of you in the name of Jesus. Sobering times like this, I'm not sure that I can ever get used to going through services of this nature. I have family hurting. You just want to reach out and give everybody a big hug, and sometimes you just don't know what to say. And this is one of those times. That we're all running a race in life. Tina Marie Gingrich has crossed the finish line. Her short span here on earth is now over.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, today, in the precious name of Jesus, today is a day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Even through the valleys of life, Lord, you are still God, and you are still our faithful Father, that we can have our hope and that we can get peace. Lord, that we can get our strength from, because the Word of God says that the joy of the Lord is my strength. And I choose today to have joy in you and continue to walk forward. And Lord, I pray for each one of the family members here today. Lord, I pray the race in life that they are running is being run well. It is being run for the glory of God. It is being run for you, and every step they take would be for the kingdom of God, Lord. And through this time, I pray that you would touch them, Lord. I pray you would touch their hearts. You would give them a hug. You would give them peace through this time. Lord, I pray today in Jesus' name that you would make yourself known unlike they've ever seen you before. Because you are faithful and you are God. You will always be God. And you are worthy today. You are worthy to be praised. And I choose today through this time to give you praise and honor and glory. For you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I have one of them, the Lord laid on my heart, one of the more popular chapters in the Word of God, Psalm chapter 23. And I want to go through that, Anna and Mary and James. Anna and Mary and James. These scriptures are for you. Know that God is there. In the days that are coming, there'll be questions on why did this have to happen. And I can promise you every question that you have, there's an answer in the Word of God for you. The Father is saying, run to me, children, to give you comfort. Verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. Or in other words, he gives me peace. And when the Lord is my shepherd, we look at this word shepherd. It's someone, it's a protector. God is your protector today. He is your everything today. He's your provider. And when we have him in our life, it says, I shall not want. There's nothing else that's needed in this life. He provides you with everything. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He gives you peace. And so I speak peace into your lives today. I pray the peace of God in your very being, in your homes, wherever you're at. Pray that he gives you and sees that he restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He leads you. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. God is saying, walk courageously. Walk as sons and daughters of mine. This is what we're living for. This is what you're living for. We're all writing our obituary today. This is what we live for. It's a celebration of life. God is saying, fear not, for I am with you. Fear not. I am with you. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I and you will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What a promise, folks. What a promise. We get to dwell with him in his house forever. He says, fear not. You were created for such a time as this. Walk in righteousness. He will lead you. He will give you peace. He will lead you into all righteousness. Someday, if you've given your heart to Jesus, you get to dwell with him in his house forever. And when we say forever, 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 there's no beginning and there's no end. And in the name of Jesus, there's no beginning and there's no end. That's our God. That's your God. The obituary for Tina Marie Gingrich. 54 of Goshen, died Tuesday, January 31st, 2023 at Goshen Hospital. She was born June 23rd, 1968 in Emily City, Michigan to Phil and Elaine Babcock. Survivors include a son, Aaron James Reedsecker of Goshen, two daughters, Anna Reedsecker of Indianapolis and Mary Schwartz of Lansing, Michigan. Three grandchildren, Addison, Zoe, and Alexander Stevens, and numerous brothers and sisters, nieces, and nephews. She was preceded in death by a son, Adam Babcock. Tina loved to spend time with her family and enjoyed writing. She confessed Jesus as her Lord and Savior. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh. She confessed Jesus as her Lord and Savior. And in her death, she gave life to three others by being an organ donor. What more do we need to say other than she confessed Jesus as her Lord and Savior? Praise be to God. The family says thank you to all who shared their love, kindness, and prayers with us during this time. All of you are welcome to stay for a meal and fellowship following the service.
I was going to write something, but I couldn't think of what to say, so I'm kind of winging it. My mom and I weren't on speaking terms for the last 8 months. But I always loved her and thought about her every day. And I guess if she could hear me, which I believe she can, I'd want her to know that I have forgiven her. I know that she's made a lot of decisions in her life, and I didn't always agree with her, and I was really mean to my mom. I really resented her. I was bitter. I was angry. I felt abandoned and rejected. But my mom loved me. She loved her daughter, Mary, and she loved both of her sons, James and Adam. She loved her grandkids, Addison and Zoe and Alex. And she loved hard. And no matter what I was going through, whether I was making the right choices, she was always there. And so my heart's broken. But I also have peace. Knowing that I was able to tell her that I had forgiven her and that I loved her. And I think the hardest thing for me was to be there in the OR room and watching her just slip away. But there was nothing I would have been, rather would have done for her. And I knew that if that would have been me, she would have been there. So I just wanted to even to say thank you to Robert for walking me through this. Every step, you never left our sides. And you really helped us hold it together. And I thank you for that and for Mom. For the adopted family. You guys have just been so awesome. Just being here. And I just thank everybody else for coming. I mean, it means so, so, so much. I know she was so loved. And so one thing I wanted to share was as she was passing, I had this vision of her. My mom had a really severe back injury, and so she walked with a limp all the time that I've known her. And as she passed through, the Lord gave me a vision of her just running, and I mean with no problems and just running. So I'm thankful for that. I believe that she's in heaven and that we're going to see her again. And so I guess a verse that's really coming to me right now, and it came on my phone this morning, was James 1, and it says to consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. And so for me, that's just something that I'm standing on, is that I don't understand. I do know that she's in a better place, but I just don't, I guess I don't understand why I wasn't able to speak with her. I felt the Lord told me no, because I am, you know, I'm sure you all know that I'm in Indianapolis and I'm trying to get my life better. And so I'm kind of upset about it. I'm not angry, but I guess you guys can just pray for me in that area. I'm just really not sure. And maybe I'll never know why I wasn't able to give her another hug or to hear her voice. So I love you, Mom.
I don't have a whole lot. I just jotted a few memories down. For those of you, I know pretty much everybody in here, for those of you who don't know who I am, I'm Robert and Lily's daughter. They are the most generous people I know. And so growing up, that meant her doors were always open to whoever needed a place to stay. And Maria was one of those that needed a safe home for a time. When she came, she said her name was Tina, but she wanted us to call her Maria. And so that's how I knew her my whole life, was Maria. So anyway, I was around 10 when she came to live in our home. And I remember Aaron had to move out of his bedroom. So us girls had the basement. And I don't remember a whole lot, but I remember she was always kind. I don't have a bad memory of her living there at all. She had a distinct laugh that I can still hear. but before she lived with us, she had lived with Maynard and Rhoda Miller, another family from our church. And I will never forget this story about her. She had a lot of stuff she needed to get rid of, emotionally, spiritually. And so I remember we went over and had a huge bonfire, and she just brought bags, and I don't know what all was in there, and apparently she forgot as well what was in the pile, because there was bullets in there. And so the fire's burning, these bullets start shooting off, and she hightailed it and ran. Like, I think she was in the next county before we stopped her. She just was like, they're after me, they're after me. Anyway, so she was became free from a lot of stuff that night, I believe. And then, yeah, through her time living with us, she had James and Anna, which became my siblings. I remember when Mary was born, she brought her around, and I remember Maria telling me, she's like, you know how I named her Mary Claire? She said her favorite movie was Sister Act. And the main character in that movie is Sister Mary Clarence. And so she named her Mary Claire after her. later on, as I got married and moved away and stuff, didn't see her a whole lot. But whenever she would come around for Christmas or Mother's Day or whatever, she would always ask about my kids and take an interest. And I will always be grateful to her for choosing life for James and Anna.
If I die young, bury me in sand, lay me down on a bed of roses, sink me in the river at dawn, send me away with the words of a love song. Uh-oh, uh-oh. Lord, make me a rainbow, I'll shine down on my mother, she'll know I'm safe with you. Oh,
I'm not sure I had heard that song before, but that was one that Maria, I guess I too know her as Maria, Tina Marie, but had asked or mentioned at one time that she would like that played at her funeral. And so in honor of that, Anna shared that it would be nice if we could play that. The part that struck me in that song was "If I Die Young." And Tina Marie was 54. And there was a lot of brokenness, a lot of pain in her life. The part of this story that I rejoice in is the fact that she confessed Christ as her Lord and Savior. Where Pastor Dan read and emphasized that. That's the part of this journey that is so beautiful, even in tears. But you know, when we first got to know Maria 33 years ago, 33 I think it was, at that time, she, for a season there, she had confessed that she said she was worshiping Satan, and she was in the occult at that time. And there was a lot of brokenness in her life already up to that time, and a lot of pain that a person her age should not have had to experience, even as a little girl. And then the enemy continued to steal and deceived her into thinking that somehow her walk with him was going to help her. And she seen that that was bringing even more and more pain and more death into her life and relationships. And by the time she came and lived with us, that was part of in that bag. She had some things in her bags and things that she was going to get rid of. And so we were praying and breaking off curses in the name of the Lord Jesus. And we said, whatever you have that was used in your involvement with the kingdom of darkness, we want to have a bonfire. And so we didn't know what all was in that bag. And it made me laugh when Audrey remembered that. But when those bullets started going, she thought, sure, the demons were after her. And we just continued to pray, and she got back. And there was deliverance that started happening in her life. And so, you know, even in this journey, even in these last days, you know, I looked at the last year of Lily and I's messenger. We have one together, and Maria was always on that, and she would continue to write to us, and we would communicate. And you know, I look over Tina Marie's life, and her greatest effectiveness, she was when she actually seemed, and I don't mean this in a bad way, but when she was in jail or in, spent times in there, she would become a mighty warrior in there. She was a Bible study teacher. I mean, she would study, she knew the word, and there was enough structure around her, and choices were being made that she didn't have to battle some things, and she could be effective. But then she'd come out, and then it was kind of like she would lose some more battles. And I really believe, those are the things. You know, the enemy may have won some skirmishes, and the enemy has stolen a lot from her over the years, but he couldn't steal the Spirit of God out of her. And you know, this last week, we were in West Virginia when we got a call that she had went into an arrest, and that she, things were pretty critical. And so we had only been there not even, I think maybe about 12, 14 hours, and we turned around and came back. And the Lord wanted us here, and we were honored to be in this last week with our children and walk with them through this. And Tim Marie had and some of you have seen maybe that she became an organ donor, and that was kind of a big deal. It was I believe it was an act that she could do that was gracious, and the children walked with her through that. And I never walked that part of a journey, and I was in settings when I knew that may have been, but wasn't actually in part of that. And when they they did that at the Goshen Hospital, and James and Anna and Mary walked with her, and they allowed us four into this operating room, but to literally hold her hand and watch the monitors, and when they finally, you know, they're never sure, and life is really in the hands of the Lord. And I was praying, God, this would be a beautiful time just to raise her back up. And I knew God could do that. And to just be with the children. And they watched. It was like, those are sacred times. And suddenly you see the beauty and even the fragileness of life itself. And like eternity gets stamped on your heart, even as you walk with somebody through that in kind of a new way. And as the children were saying goodbye to their mother, and her heartbeat slowed and then stopped, and one of the doctors said it's 8:43, I believe, was her time of death. And according to the scripture, it says, we are willing to be absent from the body and then present with the Lord. And in reality, at some moment, whether it was that exact second, but that's when the records would show, she was absent from this body and she was present with God. That's going to be a reality for every one of us someday. There's nobody that has lived that doesn't leave this body and is present with the Lord. Even Enoch, although he didn't seemed to have died, it says he was translated, he left this earth and was present with the Lord. But that's the reality of, well, what is it now, 7 billion people? Did we hit 7 billion or 8 billion in the world? Did anybody remember? 7, I think it is. But anyway, everybody that is here will one day have an appointment. So I would like to reflect a little bit on that God is a redeemer of broken people. You know, the scripture says in Romans 10, if you confess, it says, if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in thine heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And then it says, for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know, I was looking at some of the messages that Maria has written us over this just last number of months and weeks. And some of it reflects some of the pain. You know, one of the things she said recently, not very long ago, she said, you know, and it struck me because now I'm reading this knowing that she's gone. And some of these, we would have had a little bit of dialogue, others we didn't have much, but she would write regularly, and sometimes she even had a little blog that she would do some verses and things. But she just said, you know, she said, I wish I would have had somebody that would have gone through what I've gone through to reach out to me and tell me how my life is going to end before it began. And I thought about that. Friends, I don't know all the details, but I know there's going to be a day you're going to meet the Lord. That part of the ending, I know we're going to meet God, all of us. Then this is what she said in another one of her messages. She said, I want people to know that Jesus died and took the pain so we don't have to feel it. And then she added this little phrase, and so we don't have to cause it. You know what? Many of her messages to us, and some of them she would say, she was sorry she had caused pain to those that she loved. She said, I want people to know that Jesus died and took the pain so we don't have to feel it. And we don't have to cause it. And she said, and we don't have to be hurt And we don't have to hurt others because Jesus took all of that on the cross. I'm just reading a few of her direct quotes that she has here. Another one that she wrote just a number of weeks ago, she had a long message. She said, "Now I know this is a long message, but so much is weighing on my heart, and I just wanted to tell you that I love you, and I'm sorry." And she said, "Maybe I will find some beauty because right now all I have left is ashes and tears." Another one here, just a number of weeks ago, is that she said, "I love you all so very much, and I'm honored that you made me feel part of your family." And one more I'll read. She said, "I don't know why God does such great things for me, because I don't do the greatest for him. But I'm just thankful that he does." You know, God's a redeemer. He's a redeemer of broken pieces, broken hearts, broken dreams. See, when Jesus Christ came, the announcement was is that he was given by the angels was peace on earth and goodwill to men. But the promise to Joseph, and quoted in Matthew, was a virgin is going to be with child. And it was about the prophecy in the Old Testament. "And they shall call his name Emmanuel," meaning God with us. You know, there was some holy times in the room in the last couple of days with Anna, James, and Mary. Others would stop and go, but they were times. And I don't know if I'll ever forget the time when the three were just kneeling around their mother's bed. And God was there, just holding us all. Because God was with us, Emmanuel. There's a story I'd like to just share. I won't hold this long. Out of the book of Acts, Acts 16. And it was a question a Greek man asked. It was in the city of Philippi. I'd like to visit over there someday, see some of the Macedonian cities, Thessalonica, some along that coast. I think it'd be beautiful. But Paul and Silas were there. Some of the first churches were planted there. And if you remember, in Philippi, Paul and Silas were teaching, and they were sharing there's a Redeemer. This is amazing. God came and walked with us. Emmanuel happened in the man Jesus Christ, and it was a powerful message of salvation and redemption, and it was not only for the Jews, but for the Greeks, the Gentiles, and all of us, the world. There was a plan of redemption, and they were going along teaching, and suddenly there's this young lady that was a slave, and there was she was demon-possessed or given the ability by demons to speak the future or prophecies that would come true. And people would look at her and they would pay her master and then she would give them a word. And she started following Paul and Silas around. And the Bible says for many days. So it happened not just one. And she was kept calling out. She said, "These men are the servants of the Most High God. And they're showing us the way of salvation." Now, she kept following them, "Hey, listen." And here she was telling all these other things for pay, but she was just doing this because the demons knew who she was, who these men were, and they knew the truth. But Paul, finally getting tired of that and was not wanting to hear that from the demonic realm. And finally, it says, after many days, Paul turns around and he says, "In the name of Jesus, I command you, spirit, leave her. Looser, be gone." And instantly the demons left her and she quit doing that. And not only that, she was free. She was free from the bondage of Satan's hold, but she was also free from that ability that her masters were using to keep her in slavery, and they were angry because now their source of income was suddenly dried up. Now they could have, if they would have left her, walk in the power of the Holy Spirit, by the Holy Spirit, had words of wisdom and discernment and insight, and she could have maybe given words of encouragement to others by the power of God, because God's greater than the enemy. But they weren't interested in that. In fact, they were so angry that they had Paul and Silas arrested and said, these guys are causing uproar and disruption. And then they had them beaten, said laid on their beaten with rods and whips or whatever, with many beatings. And says, and then put them into a prison, not just in the general population, not even into extra security, but into the dungeon where there was just, that's where they would pay, put them to die. It was really a hole that they would put them in, and they had them in the very, and had them in stocks and in bond, I mean in leg bondings. And Paul and Silas, it said, were singing at midnight, singing. Man, I had to think of that. You know where that comes out of? That comes out of an anointing or a baptism of the Spirit, because you can't do that out of the flesh. The flesh is saying, man, you heard as bad as I do. Hey, don't touch that part. They were singing. They were singing praises to God at midnight. And that it would come up out of there, and it's most likely the whole jail heard. I don't know how big it was. Probably wasn't a huge jail, but for Philippi, it would have been the jail. And probably was run by a retired soldier, man of the Roman soldiers. That would not have been unusual. It says that we don't know for sure, but some of the, and that said, it would have never been it wouldn't have been a Jew. Jews didn't run Roman jails. It would have been a Greek of some kind. But anyway, this guy was the master of this jail. And Romans had a strict code of honor, strict code of practice, of discipline. The Romans knew if you let your prisoner go, it's your life. And at midnight, there's an earthquake. And the doors flew open. And I mean, this was an unusual earthquake because it even popped the shackles that were on the ankles of Paul and Silas. And they were loosed. Everybody was loosed. And Paul and Silas come crawling out of there. And the doors are open, and the jailer comes out late at night, looks with a light, sees the doors are open, and he just knows they're gone. It doesn't take him long. He knows what's happening to him. He draws his knife, and he's going to kill himself. Because there wasn't going to be a jury trial. It wasn't going to be nothing. It didn't matter if there was an earthquake. He knew what was there. And he was going to end his life. And Paul says, oh, hey, listen, we're all here. We're all here. Don't end your life. Don't kill yourself. And he calls and checks, and he's amazed they're all there. And then he says, who are you guys? What is it? And he brings them in, and he washes them. And he says, and they tell him. And his question is this. It's a question of the ages. It's in verse 30 of chapter 16. He says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? Because he just looked at eternity. He was dead. He was going to kill himself. You know, you can't walk through this time, and you couldn't have walked through what these children did without having a clear stamp of eternity, time, the preciousness of life. The presence of God was there, Emmanuel. This guy, the jailer, in this disaster, in the crisis, he sees somehow there's a God Who is this? What must I do to be saved? You know, it's interesting to me. It wasn't along, okay, well, you got 10 weeks of this, 3 months of this study. First of all, my friend, you're going to have to learn how to dress. It was none of those things. I'm not against any of us helping people understand, but somehow it was very straight. And they simply said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. And then it says, and even at that hour of the night, the jailer cared for them, washed their wounds. Then he and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. It says at midnight, there was a baptism. So what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? Wow. You know, in John 3:16, talks about how God loved us. He loved the world so much he gave his only son. And again, it uses this term that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So what do we need to be saved from? In Romans, it talks about the wages of sin is death. We all sinned. We all deserve to die. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And so now the question is for us. What if I were to die tonight? Do I know for sure I'd be saved? Is there a question in my heart? Because friends, you know, even as Tina Marie gave part of the organs to bring life, I don't think there'd be a greater honor or specialness than for her to know that in her memorial service, someone gave their heart to the Lord and said, I want to believe. I want Jesus Christ. I want to be filled with his Spirit. That's why Jesus came, is to set people free, to bring healing to broken hearts and set captives free. Jesus read that in Luke 4, he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted and to proclaim liberty to the captives and the recovering of sight to the blind and set at liberty to those who are oppressed. Again, I just want to thank each of you for being here, and I want to especially just speak that healing over James and Anna and Mary. Derek, and the grandchildren, Addie and Zoe and Alex, but each one involved. Yeah. You know, when I think of Maria, I think of the passage in Matthew when Jesus said, you know, it says there in Matthew 15, or 12, verse 15, he says, and anybody that followed him, he healed all the sick among them. And then it says this, it was in fulfillment of a prophecy out of the Old Testament. It says, he will not crush the weakest reed, nor will he put out a flickering wick or candle. As I look through the last year of communication with Tina Marie, there were times that was flickering. It seemed like it was just about broke off. But God says, I don't break those off. He holds it. He protects the flame. And he doesn't allow the enemy to steal his spirit from within an individual. Even when we make bad choices, there's consequences. We lose. The enemy steals, kills, and destroys. And I believe we've seen that. And I've seen God in so many ways in this last number of days. I don't remember seeing so many nurses and doctors, even as this procession was going down to the operating room. They were lining the walls. I don't know. I think there was 60, 70, maybe even more, 80, I don't know, of staff along there. And as the children were walking with their mother. And then in the waiting room, and the one doctor came after, and he had tears in his cheeks, and he was hugging us. And he just, I was amazed. He gave me his number, and he said, if the children need anything, or you need, just, I want to know. Because God was there. God was with us. So I just want to worship the Lord in this time. And thank him for all the memories that we do have. And thank him that he's a redeemer of the broken parts that shouldn't have been. And he can bring life even out of those. So I pray a blessing for Anna, Mary, and James, and a special. Father, thank you. God, I thank you that we were able to walk with Tina Marie these last 30-some years. God, I don't believe this was what you had in mind. I know you had a walk of victory for her, and somehow, Lord, the enemy stole things that I don't believe he should have been able to do. But God, I thank you that even now, Lord, that no one could steal or put out the fire of your spirit. And I thank you that you're present here today. And I speak life now over this body. And God, if any of the children or grandchildren need a touch of heaven, I just ask and invite a special anointing, a touch from heaven by the Holy Spirit. God, I pray if someone is here that chooses to believe in their heart and confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus, God, that you would hear that promise, that decision, and God, you would seal it by the Spirit, and that there would be new life, even in this time of passing and death. So God, I pray a blessing now on Anna. She is going back to Indianapolis. God, for Mary, as she goes back to Lansing, God, be with her. I pray for James as he is here in Goshen. God, I pray for these three. And I thank you for holding them on this journey. God, I pray too for Derek, as he was a special friend. And God, I pray for Ricky and for each of the grandchildren. And God, for the friends and family relation that may be here. Thank you. And God, now we just want to pause and say thank you for the meal that's prepared. And Father God, would you bless our fellowshipping, and may we sense your peace here as we just share together, maybe laugh together and cry together as we think about Maria, Tina Marie, Lord, and her laughter, her love for life, and her uniqueness. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. So God, we pray, you would lead and bless this time. We thank you for holding us and being with us this evening in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Friends, there's going to be one closing song. The caretakers are going to take the pulpit here, and the family will follow. And those that are here, you're just welcome to follow after that. And we encourage you all to come, and they have plenty of food. And so just come over to the fellowship hall. Because of the lateness of this service, we were going to have more of a private family burial tomorrow morning at 9:30. So we'll finish the committal tomorrow. So thank you again for coming.